right, here we go. It is time for glide ratios. That was very Dr. Seuss-ish, don't you think? All right, make sure you're on your Notability document called glide ratios and follow along. Don't be on other things, okay? So here we go. We talked about unit rates, okay? I'm gonna like push forward a little bit through this activity to teach you things about unit rates and a little bit with proportions and things like that. Some things again that you've done in sixth grade, okay? So follow along and you'll be good. So let's talk about what is glide ratio, and I want you to check this out here, okay?
Whoa, check this out. That is so cool.
Check this out.
Oh, cool. Sweet.
When a flying squirrel glides, it moves forward and down at the same time. This is called glide ratio. It's the ratio of the forward distance to its downward distance in the absence of wind or power. The glide ratio of a flying squirrel is 2:1, meaning it goes 2 feet forward for every 1 foot down.
I wonder if those squirrels understand the math behind how they're flying.
They don't need to understand it, they do it.
Well, they certainly depend on getting their ratio right, otherwise they're toast.
So here's the assignment. How can you represent the glide ratio of a flying squirrel? Which representations work best to show equivalent glide ratios? All right, well, let's see how many different ways we can show glide ratio.
Okay. Well, you can use a double number line to show the glide ratio 2:1. And it's easy to show the equivalent ratios of 4:2, 6:3, 8:4.
You can also use a ratio table to show the glide ratio 2:1. It also makes it easy to see the equivalent ratios of 4:2, 6:3, and 8:4.
Or we could use a tape diagram to show the glide ratio 8:4. And then if we wanted to show the equivalent ratio, we can make a new tape diagram to show the equivalent glide ratio 6:3.
If I wanted to show equivalent glide ratios easily, I think I would use the double number line or the ratio table.
And guess what? We talked about we're not using either of those, but you could, right? But we have more of a mathematical way to do it that doesn't involve as much setup and things like that. So let's skip right to that. All right, this is your document here that I want you to take a look at, and it's called glide ratio, okay? And so it says a glide ratio for an object or organism in flight is the ratio of forward distance to vertical distance, but realize in the absence of power and wind, okay? So if you had some sort of fan attached to you, obviously the glide ratio would not be consistent. Or if you have some updraft of wind, that might change the glide ratio's trajectory. So realize that's why we add that in there, okay? This ratio though, if you're a flying squirrel or something, has a constant value. We've talked about a constant of proportionality, and is treated as a feature of the object or organism. So that object or that flying squirrel has a certain glide ratio, okay? So here's a glide ratio for a white-backed vulture, okay? So a white-backed vulture, right there, that big vulture thing, that's huge. Imagine that, like attacking your face. That vulture has a glide ratio of 75:5, okay? And so that tells us that it can glide 75 feet forward for every 5 feet it descends down, okay? And so it says, what is the glide ratio of the white-backed vulture as a unit rate? Okay, let me switch to here, hold on. There we go, okay. And so what I want you to do is we've talked about unit rates before. Keep it very, very simple. So I want you to go ahead and write down where's my pen? There we go. I want you to write down on here the unit rate or the ratio that exists right now, which is 75:5, but we always need to label. Okay, sorry, I should get my head out of the way, okay? So we have 75, and what is that 75? That's 75 feet forward, and let's just put an arrow forward, for every 5 feet down, okay, or it descends, Okay? And so that's our current ratio. We want to find the unit rate. So what did we say? To find the unit rate, you just divide the numerator by the denominator, and that answer is what you get over 1. Okay? And so we're going to set it up, and that's just, we know 75 divided by 5. So at that point, you can either just know it, or you can pull out your calculator, 75 divided by 5, and we get 15. So remember, that's 15 feet forward, okay, per 1 foot down, okay? And so that is our unit rate for the white-backed vulture. Okay. So let's go ahead and take a look at this white-back vulture table. So we really want to expand this out to sort of see what does it look like for different situations, and then we're going to graph it as well. So we have vertical descent of 1 foot, okay? And so we've already seen that right here, okay? So for every 1 foot, the horizontal distance is 15 feet. Okay, so vertical distance versus horizontal distance, okay? So what if we do 75 feet, or what if the vertical distance changes? So now what we're gonna do is you can think of a couple things. So remember, ratios, if you find the equivalent ratio or fraction, okay, because they have a constant of proportionality, you're gonna be able to just find that other number. Okay, or you can set up a proportion, things like that, that we'll talk about in a second, okay? So let's go ahead and look at getting to that, these other numbers. So option 1 is just, I can look at this, and we've seen this with a table before. I could just go, well, okay, so this is sort of easy. I'm currently at a 1, and I wanna get to a 20, okay, so this is sort of what I'm looking at, 1/15th, and my goal is to make it equivalent to 20 over something, okay? So if I want to do that, I could just think, okay, well, what's sort of the multiplier that we're going to multiply by the numerator and the denominator to get to that other fraction? And so we can see, well, obviously, this is times 20, and whatever we do the top, we do the bottom so that it's equivalent, we're not changing anything other than the way it looks, okay? And so we have 1 times 20 is 20, so 15 times 20, we have a 30, and add on the 0 is 300, okay? And so that's one option for us, is just visually go, okay, like I can move things one way or another, okay? Another option for us is to set up an actual proportion. So I do want to revisit that with you from sixth grade. So I want you to set this up with me down here. I'll go to blue. And so we have 1 over 15. And I want you to set it equivalent to the thing you're trying to make. And so if you look, the 75 is on the bottom, and X would be in our numerator because we don't know what that is. So let me zoom in on that for you real quick, okay? So now we can go ahead and solve this. And again, when you set up the proportion like this, we're saying the one ratio is equivalent to the other one, okay? And so you have two options. You could say, well, 15 times something equals 75. And so I would just do the same things to the top and the bottom, and we solve that one just like we did before. The other option is, I don't know if you remember this from sixth grade, is the means extremes or cross multiplying. And that's where you take 15 times X and get 15X, and it would equal the 75 times 1, which would be 75, and then you can solve for X. So to get X by itself, divide by 15, divide by 15, and we get X equals, and then you just have to think, well, how many 15s are in 75? Or you can just do 75 divided by 15, and you can see that we get 5, okay? And so 5 is here, and it allows us to put the 5 up in the table. So you have a couple options there to do. So let's go ahead and take a look at the 900 and the 100 and get these filled out. So what I want you to do right now, let's pause the video and in this space over here. Use whichever method you want to figure out what those missing spots are. And remember, we're just taking the original ratio that was given, that was figured out with us here, this unit rate, and we're pushing it and finding equivalent fractions if a denominator was 900 or if the numerator was 100, okay? And so I want you to go ahead, pause, figure that out, and then you can see how you did. All right, now that you got that done, let's take a look, okay? And so I have 1/15, and so 900 divided by 15, my multiplier was 60, and so 1 times 60 is 60. So if you got 60 for the 900, you did well with that. Same thing up here. If I multiply times 100 to get that far one, then I'd have to multiply by 100 for the 15, and I would get 1,500. So if you got 1,500, you were good with that too, in whatever way you did that. Okay, so let's go ahead and graph this now. We're gonna actually graph it with the vertical height or drop on the bottom. So this, let's go ahead and label this as our vertical, the vertical descent, okay? So we have V-E-R-T-I-C-A-L and D-E-S-C-E-N-T. Okay, and then let's do our arrow down to show that like descent or drop, okay? And then this side here will be our horizontal distance. So let's write that on the side, horizontal distance, okay? And so that's going that way with my arrow. So these are our the X and Y axis that we wanna have labeled. So let's go ahead and graph these now. And we have to graph them this way because you can see the numbers go all the way up to 1,500 here, and this scale is going up to 1,500. So that's why that has to be there. If we made our own, we could have made it different, but this is how we're doing it, okay? So let's plot those little points and we'll see what this looks like as an equivalent, as a bunch of equivalent fractions that are ratios that are equivalent to each other. Let's see what it looks like as a graph. So 1 and 15, so that's vertical 1, and you have to look at what these are counting by. So 5, 10, 15, 20, no, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, probably 2s, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, yeah, counting by 2s. So we have going over 1 with a 1 vertical descent, our horizontal distance is 15. So over 1, here's where 1 is. And then let's look at what the intervals are on here. So we have 100, 200, 300. So these are by 100s. So if we're going up 15, that's not really that much. So let's just put a point pretty close to the origin there, something like that. Okay, and then let's do our next one. So the vertical is 5. And the horizontal distance is 75. So we're going over 5, up 75, okay? So there's our 2, 4, here's our 5 here, and we're going up 75. So almost to that 100 mark, about 3/4 up that box, right? So there's our next point, okay? Let's go ahead and continue the next one. So over to 20, up 300. So that's a nice easy one. 1, 2, 3. So there's our point there. Okay. Over 60, up 900. So there's the 500, 600, 700, 800, 900. There's that one there. I'll darken these in a little bit for us. And you can start to see this trend that exists already with this graph. And then the last one is 100 and 1,500. That puts us all the way up at the top corner, okay? So we could probably go ahead and easily, you can see, draw this line and see the trend or the glide ratio that exists, okay? I want you to be good at really understanding what this means. So let's go to your proportional explanation. And so what that means is, actually explain to me what's happening with the graph. What are you visually seeing? Okay, so let's talk about it in terms of that vertical descent, or really like how high you are up, okay? So if you're up 100 feet from the ground and jumping off and you have this glide ratio, you're able to descend horizontally 1,500 feet from that point, okay? So it lets you know how far you go that way depending on how high you start up. So really important if you're like base jumping or stuff and you wanna know like what your glide ratio is, where you're gonna eventually land and that kind of thing. So let's go ahead and put that into words, and I'm gonna help you with this first one. So we're gonna say, as the vertical height, okay, or it's sort of like our descent, you know, it is what we're descending also, but as our vertical height increases, okay, so that's what this means here. So if you look here, as our vertical height increases, we're at 1 height or 5 feet high, 20 feet high, 60 feet high. As our height gets higher, what is happening to our horizontal distance numbers? Are they dropping or are they getting higher as well? If you said they get higher as well or thought that, that's good. Okay. So as our vertical height increases, comma, the horizontal distance increases or gets larger or gets farther, whatever you would say. Okay, so that's what we're doing for there. Let's take a look at this. I have to stop this a little bit early because some of the people, as they injure themselves, say some bad words. So I can only show you just a little bit of this. It says, why are glide ratios important? Well, here's why. If you don't understand glide ratios and you don't understand that you're not an animal that has a glide ratio, or by adding an umbrella, you still don't really have much of a glide ratio, then maybe you're an idiot and, I don't know, should rethink some things, but. Oh, wasn't a bad jump, right? Wow! Oh. Go, you can do it! I'm getting a little bit nervous. I don't remember which clip ends up getting bad, but you can see maybe they had a little glide ratio. I don't know. All right, so let's head to this page and we'll talk about sailplanes, paragliders, and then what we'll do on Monday is I'm going to give you some actual launchers and planes, and you are going to launch these planes from different heights and determine if they have a glide ratio and what that looks like. So we're just setting up for that to make sure you're good. All right, so here we go. We have a glide ratio for a sailplane. That's this. So they actually launch these out of from the backs of planes. They pull them on a rope, and then they release it, and then they just glide, and that's how they work. It's really, really cool. And then we also have a paraglider here. I don't know if any of you have ever done this before, but it's a pretty cool experience. So those have a glide ratio as well. So here's the sailplane. You can see the glide ratio. Look at that, 150:3, okay? And then we also have a glide ratio of forward distance to descent for a paraglider is 24:4. But that plane, think about that, forward distance, for 100, every 150 feet of forward distance, it only drops 3 feet. That's crazy. It can really, really go pretty far. So let's find the unit rate for each of these types of gliders. So I'm gonna zoom in on this a little bit. Let's separate your workspace here, because we have the two kinds of gliders. Let's do the SP, the sailplane, first. So the sailplane is 150, and remember that is feet forward. So always do your labels to 3 feet descent or downward, okay? And we need to find the unit rate. How do we find the unit rate? Remember, we just divide the what? Numerator and the denominator, and it creates your unit rate over one, okay? So we have 150 divided by 3, and so what is the unit rate? If you know it, great. If not, you just plug it in, 150 divided by 3, and you have 50. There you go. Okay, so we have 50 feet of forward motion gives us only 1 foot of descent. So that's the unit rate of forward to a single foot. Okay. All right, let's check out the unit rate for the paraglider. So let's do PG for paraglider and figure this one out. So it's 24 forward takes them down 4 feet. Okay. Go ahead and let's calculate this one. So do that on your own with your calculator or in your head. I mean, it's 24 divided by 4. So 24 divided by 4 equals 6. And so we have 6 feet of forward motion will take us down 1 foot of descent. So make sure you have your labels there for that unit rate. So there's our unit rates. You can see that a paraglider, or not the paraglider, the sailplane is going to get way more forward distance per foot than the paraglider does. All right, so let's do our explanation here. Okay, so the sailplane ratio explanation, okay? I want you to write this one specifically. So for every 50 feet traveled, which direction? For every 50 feet traveled forward, the sailplane descends, what? 1 foot. So that's the sentence that explains the unit rate for the sailplane. So let's go ahead and do the paraglider now, okay? Imitate what I did there, and I want you to say the same thing for this one, okay? So for every 50 feet traveled forward, the sailplane descends 1 foot. So for every what? For the paraglider. So go ahead and write that yourself. And then we'll move on to the next one. Go ahead and pause if you need. All right, so if you wrote for every 6 feet traveled forward, the paraglider descends 1 foot, then you did a good job. All right, let's take a look at this one here. Use the glide ratio of the paraglider to determine how high of a cliff you would need to jump from to reach a landing point on the other side of a ravine that is 370 feet forward from your current location. So let's talk about setting up a proportion and what this would look like. This is something that you should have seen in sixth grade, but it'll be a good review for you. Okay, so start with your unit rate for the paraglider. And our unit rate for the paraglider, remember, is, so pay attention to the order, is 6 feet forward for every 1 foot down. Okay, so we have 6 feet forward is 1 foot down. So that's our unit rate. Sorry, my head's in the way again. 6 feet forward for 1 foot down. And let's set it equivalent to what we want to create. That's how I want you to sort of think about that in your head. And so what I want to know is I have this ravine and that is 370 feet forward that I need to get over. So my goal is to get at least 370 feet forward from the point that I'm at right now, okay? And so if that's my unit rate, my goal would be to go 370 feet forward. Ooh, that's big, huh? Okay, so that's my goal, is to change it to that. And I'm curious how high I would have to be off the ground to make that happen. So this is gonna be my X. So this is the proportion that you're setting up that I want to see everyone have. So remember, you have a couple options now, okay? You can ask yourself, well, does 6 times something equal 370? And then I found the multiplier and I can just make an equivalent fraction from here to here. If not, I may need to cross multiply and do the work that way. So let's go ahead and test it out. So 6 times what is 370? We can do that division, right? And let's see if it works out. 370 divided by 6. It's a repeating decimal. You cannot do work with repeating decimals. So we're not going to do that. We're not going to change it to a fraction. That means for this one, the path is to use the cross multiplying or means and extremes. So I'm going to go ahead and get rid of this plan here. And let's go ahead and do the cross multiplying. I always tell people just start with the X cross right here. That way you're just really consistent. Okay, and so we have 6x equals, and then you can do your other cross, 370 times 1, which is always going to be nice and easy. Okay, and now we have solving this by dividing x by both sides. Okay, and you end up with x equals 376. We're going to get that weird decimal anyway, 370 divided by 6. 61.6 repeating. So let's just go ahead and put 61.6 repeating and realize what that is. That goes here. So what is that? That's feet descent, or really the amount of height that I need to start at if I want to go 370 feet. So this is my answer right here. And so how high of a cliff would you need to jump from?
Don't be scared!
Probably to be safe, 62 feet high of a cliff, okay? All right, so let's use that same understanding to take care of the glide ratio of the sailplane. And this is our last thing for today. Okay, so use the glide ratio of the sailplane to determine where the plane will land if released from 10,000 feet in the air, assuming it does not use thermals to increase its height in the air, which is something they actually do to go a further distance. All right, so let's go ahead. We need the ratio of the sailplane, and that is right here. So 50 feet forward will drop 1 foot. So let's set it up. So we have 50 feet forward will give us a 1 foot of a descent. So set up a proportion and set it equal to what you want to find. So what do we want to find? We want to find, well, what if I release it from 10,000 feet high? So think about which one that is. Is it this one? Is that height or is this height? So if you're thinking the denominator, right, the descent is also like the height, like how high we're starting. So let's plug in the 10,000. So there's our 10,000 feet. And so we want to know where will the plane land, meaning how far horizontally will it go if I start at 10,000 feet instead of 1 foot, okay? And so we have x here. And this one's pretty nice because, look, here's my multiplier. Times the 1 times 10,000 equals 10,000. So to make an equivalent fraction or equivalent ratio, we do the same thing to the numerator. And so we're just doing 50 times 10,000, just like we would do 1 times 10,000 on the in the denominator as well. And so you have 50 times 10,000. Look at this. I mean, you can do it mental math too, just fine. But 10, 1, 2, 3 times 50. Is 500,000. The reason sometimes I just put up a calculator for you, oh, I guess you don't see it, do you? Is because I want you to realize like it's not a big deal. Remember, our purpose is to take care of this stuff. I'm not worried about the calculator stuff. So we have x equals 500,000. And what is that? That's why we look back at our units. It is 50 feet. Or is feet forward. Okay, so it'll go 500,000 feet forward if dropped from 10,000 feet in the air. So pretty crazy. That'd be a fun ride. I wonder if you'd do that. All right, so that's all you need for right now. Like I said, on Monday, we'll get the actual planes out and the launchers and things like that and start launching these off from different heights and see what the glide ratio is on these little paper airplanes I got from Dollar Tree. So that'll be up next. Don't forget also, if you did not bring Oreos, I need you to bring Oreos because that's also an activity we have going on next. All right, so you can save that document, exit out of that, and it is time to jump to the next task for the day. See ya.